7 o'clock Central Standard Time, 7 p.m. That is. Guess that's 2100 hours. May 8th, 2023. Bible in a Bar, Hobbs Island Pit Stop, Huntsville, Alabama, USA. Miles Wiley Albright. Let's pray. We're grateful, Father. We're humbled and honored at the same time. Thank you, sir, for speaking to us. Thank you for speaking to us by your Holy Spirit directly and for speaking to us through the written word of God and speaking to us about the written word of God through your Holy Spirit. And especially tonight, we say that in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. So, speaking of Holy Spirit speaking about scripture, I'm going to get to that a little further down. But to start with, we're just going to give you kind of a line upon line rote teaching. And then we're going to get to the Holy Spirit encounter that I had on May 3rd of 2023. This is May the 8th. To start with, this looks like just a kind of a random factoid. Manasseh was one of the last kings of Judah. He was two, four, six, the seventh king from the end of Judah. Judah was the southern kingdom. He reigned for 55 years, and he was also the worst of the worst, and was the direct precipitor of disaster, the disaster of the Babylonian exile. Interesting factoid. Following him was his son Ammon, his grandson Josiah, his son Jehoahaz, Jehoiakim, Zedekiah, and a grandson Jehoiachin. But anyway, those years add up to 2 years, 31 years, 11 years, 11 years, add up to 55 years. He ruled for 55 years. Okay. I'll come back to that. Put a parenthesis there or a pause or whatever. But he caused the exile according to the inerrant word of God. 2 Kings 24. 2 Kings 24. This is going to be page in the Most Holy Bible. It's going to be page 458. 458. We have a Hebrew Greek keyword study Bible that we favor around here, the NIV. And we get a lot of mileage out of it. 2 Kings 24, 1 through 4. 2 Kings 24, 1 through 4. And this is in the time of Jehoah of Manasseh's great grandson, Jehoiakim. Okay, Manasseh had a son who had a son who had this guy, Jehoiakim. And starting with verse 1, during Jehoiakim's reign, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, invaded the land, and Jehoiakim became his vassal for 3 years. But then he changed his mind and rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar. The Lord sent Babylonian, Aramean, Moabite, and Ammonite raiders against him. He sent them to destroy Judah in accordance with the word of the Lord proclaimed by his servants, the prophets. Now, by the way, Jeremiah reigns from right along reigns, or his ministry was right the 13th year of Josiah, all the way to they went off to the Babylonian exile, okay? And that was 51 years. So Jeremiah had a long ministry. He served the God for 51 years, and he was one of these prophets. Even though it doesn't say so here in 2 Kings, it's prophets plural, which is interesting. But he served during that time, and he was one of the ones that served during that time. and warned Israel. Okay, verse 3. Surely these things happened to Judah according to the Lord's command in order to remove them from his presence because of the sins of Manasseh and all he had done, including the shedding of innocent blood, for he had filled Jerusalem with innocent blood, and the Lord was not willing to forgive. They were not willing to repent, was the backside of that. But again, Manasseh's here, and this is being spoken in the time of Jehoiakim, and but it's about the sins all the way back here. Okay, 2 Chronicles 33, 1 through 13. 2 Chronicles 33, 2 Chronicles is the next book after Kings, okay, to the right there. 2 Chronicles 33, verse 1. Chronicles gives us some notes, information that Kings doesn't give, and vice versa. Actually, there's some stuff in Kings, kind of like with the Gospels. Okay, verse 1, Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 55 years. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord, following the detestable practices of the nations the Lord had driven out before the Israelites. He rebuilt the high places his father Hezekiah had demolished. They weren't supposed to be worshiping God anywhere they chose. Specifically, Deuteronomy specifies to the one place that I will choose you to go and no other place. Because think about this. This is something we talked about recently. They had no Bible. Only maybe a few people in the temple had a copy of the Bible. The Bibles were hand copied with primitive instruments like feathers on goat skin. Extremely expensive, extremely hard to do. And so they had no Bibles. And in these high places, they had no Levites who were trained in the Torah. And over a period of generations, if they went out and worshiped wherever they wanted to, they would gradually move into great error. Leviticus refers to them worshiping as wherever they chose and worshiping what the NIV calls the goat idols, but it literally says the hairy ones. Now, there's another story, but we won't go on, but they weren't supposed to have these high places. Most of the kings didn't deal with them. Hezekiah, Manasseh's father, did deal with them, but he replaces them. He also erected altars to the Baals and made Asherah poles. Asherah poles are like totem poles. Generally, the Baal is the male side of the deity, and Asherah is the female. He bowed down to all the starry hosts and worshiped them. He built altars in the temple of the Lord. I have to strain to say that. He built altars in the temple of Yahweh, of which the Lord had said, my name will remain in Jerusalem forever. There was a conditional promise that if they obeyed God, the temple, his name would remain there, his presence would remain there, but only if they obeyed him. And here is that promise being abrogated by the disobedience of Israel. And you can see why, because we hadn't gotten to the worst of the worst yet. We hadn't gotten to the worst of the worst yet. That reminds me, let me make sure my phone's off. Okay, he built altars in the temple of the Lord, which the Lord had said, my name will remain in Jerusalem forever. In both courts, these are demonic altars, y'all. In both courts of the temple of the Lord, both courts, in outer and inner, he built altars to the starry hosts. He sacrificed his sons. That's plural, if you'll notice there. Now think about it. Manasseh is descending from David. He's killing his own kids, sacrificing them to demons. The descendants of David are being sacrificed to demons. Now, you want to know why what he did caused strongholds that had to be judged? That he sacrificed his sons to demons, probably on some of these altars that he had erected inside the holy place in the Lord's temple. Okay. He sacrificed his sons in the fire in the valley of Ben-Hinnom, practiced sorcery, divination, and witchcraft, and consulted mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the eyes of the Lord, provoking him to anger. He took the carved image he had made and put it in God's temple, which God had said to David and to son Solomon, in this temple and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, I will put my name forever. I will not again make the feet of the Israelites leave the land I assigned. In other words, there would never be an exile if you obey. But this is prophesying that there is going to be an exile. And this is why. I assigned to your forefathers, if only they will be careful to do everything I commanded them concerning all the laws and decrees and ordinances given through Moses. But Manasseh led Judah and the people of Jerusalem astray, so that they did more evil than the nations the Lord had destroyed before the Israelites. And that's a lot. Even back in the time of Abraham, God spoke of the sin of the Amorites reaching its fulfillment and the land vomiting them out, spewing them out. So now the same thing is happening, only worse according to this, with the children of God. Verse 10, the Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they paid no attention. So the Lord brought against them the army commanders of the king of Assyria, get this, who took Manasseh prisoner, put a hook in his nose, bound him with bronze shackles, and took him to Babylon. He is exiled to Babylon temporarily with a hook in his nose. The king, descended from David, that has slaughtered his own sons, put a hook in his nose and bound him with bronze shackles and took him to Babylon in his distress. Yeah, I guess so. He sought the favor of the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers. And when he prayed to him, the Lord was moved by his entreaty and listened to his plea. So he brought him back to Jerusalem and to his kingdom. And then Manasseh knew that the Lord is God. Yeah. Okay. Think about that. I think that's the greatest example of grace in the Bible, greater than that of shown David. Because over a period of time, he repeatedly sacrificed his own children to demons. And he did these horrible things in the temple that was so holy, only the priests could go into the holy place. Only the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies. Now, we don't know if he put stuff up inside the Holy of Holies. I wouldn't doubt it, but I don't know. But we know it's at least in the holy place, in there with the showbread and the oil lamp, the lamp is, and the altar of incense. They got these demonic deals, and it gets worse. And it gets worse. And it gets worse. Look at 2 Kings 23:7. How can it get worse than that? Well, maybe this is not worse, but to me, it seems worse. 2 Kings 23. And verse 7. Okay, now this is going to tell us about something that happened in Josiah's day. Okay, we're going to start reading about what Josiah brought revival, the grandson of Manasseh. Josiah brought revival for 31 years, and he had to clean up some things left over from what Manasseh had done. So this tells us a little more specifics of what Manasseh had done. This is happening in the time of Josiah, the grandson of Manasseh. Pick up verse 6. He, Josiah, took the Asherah pole from the temple of the Lord to the Kidron Valley outside Jerusalem and burned it there. He ground it to powder and scattered the dust over the graves of the common people. Verse 7. Brace yourself for this. He also tore down the quarters of the male shrine prostitutes, which were in the temple of Yahweh, where the women did weaving for Asherah. Okay, do you know what that just said? Male shrine prostitutes. What that means is there were homosexual men who were prostitutes, and one translation calls these places that booths, calls them quarters here. There were quarters, there were booths. He made the temple of God into a homosexual brothel. Right here, crickets. He made the Temple of Solomon, the place where only the priests were qualified to go, was a place where there was traffic. They were trafficking and homosexual prostitution in the temple. That's breathtaking. I don't guess you heard that in a sermon lately. Okay. Now, it's kind of a shocker. But look, it's in the Bible. It's in black and white. Somebody needs to see it. And I really didn't volunteer to do this. I had an encounter with God on May the 3rd about this. And I'm afraid it's also about the United States of America. Okay, this is going to sound like it's not really relevant, but I'm going to back up. By the way, this is watered down sweet tea. So it's semi-sweet tea. I don't know. I guess it's the color of brandy or whiskey or something, but that ain't what it is. I don't want to get a bad reputation. I don't want to fight any battles. I don't have to. I'm fighting enough battles. Speaking of battles, this doesn't sound relevant, but the Lord has been teaching us. I'm 71 years old. And for the first time in my life, it's becoming really, really front and center clear to me about how important deliverance for Christians also is for us, as well as healing. And that deliverance is connected to healing. And so I've been taking stock in my own life, looking for avenues that the enemy may be using against me. Especially, I've had a couple of health issues lately. And I kind of think those health issues are the Lord knocking on my door, telling me to pay attention. Okay. I've had, on and off in my life, I've had what I just considered to be dreams. Sexual dreams, but I believe that the Holy Spirit, there's a lot of people teaching on deliverance right now, and they teach on something called incubus, succubus, Lilith, and spirit spouse. Okay, I've heard of all three of those first three, you know, all my life, most of my life. I've heard of those spirits, and I kind of go, yeah, well, maybe, but I am totally convinced now that these are demonic entities. And these kind of things have not been that often, but enough to where every once in a while you wake up feeling defiled. Also, I have a tendency to have dreams where I'm kind of tormented by, I'm trying to work this out or that out. I'm trying to herding cats. I'm trying to fix something. I'm trying to get, I'm on a journey and I'm getting sidetracked and lost. And I'm trying to lead people and yada, yada, yada. And there's a tormenting sense, and you wake up almost out of breath. You wake up tired. You know, I believe these are very small demons, maybe third class demons, but they're assigned any amount that they can weaken somebody that's a pivotal person, and I believe that I am. It's really important. And so I have begun to, at night, my wife and I pray for each other, but then there's some things you got to do for yourself. And I've been binding and expelling all these spirits of incubus, succubus, Lilith, and spirit spouse, and expelling them from me, as well as these spirits of what I call toil, these spirits of toil and torment, and even causing you to feel guilty about stuff. And I've been doing this now for 2 or 3 weeks, but there was a moment, and it's interesting that it was on May the 1st, because May the 1st is a high holy day in the occult. And it seems like there's more stuff that gets stirred up on those days. And on May 1st, I had the worst of the worst. Even though I had done the prayer or done the expelling or the deliverance on myself the night before, I had the worst of the worst of the encounters with both the sexual spirit and this toil spirit. I'll tell you about the toil spirit. In the toil spirit, I was leading a group of five people robbing a bank. We were robbing a bank, okay? I was a leader, and to me, it was just not even questionable. Yeah, it was my idea. Yeah, we're doing this, and it wasn't going well, and things were kind of falling apart, and it's herding cats. And I woke up so tired. I mean, I got hormones, so I see how the spirits could ride on sexual things, but come on. I've never been tempted to go down to First National with a 45 and rob a bank. That's a little over the top. That's the enemy overplaying his hand. But I felt so defiled that morning that there was almost like a voice, quit coming. You're just stirring these things up and making things worse. But I sought the Lord, and I felt like he said, no, when you're stirring them up like this, it's right before your breakthrough. It's right before your breakthrough. So that was May the 1st, and I pressed in, and on the morning of May 3rd, I had a visitation from God. Instead of having the devils harass me, condemn me, defile me, I had a visitation from God. And yes, I'm a student of the Old Testament. Yes, I know quite a bit about the Old Testament. I've been studying it since I was 13. Yes, but what I got, you couldn't get this without revelation. The Lord spoke to me about facts in the Bible that I didn't know were there. And he spoke to me and he said, the number of years that Manasseh reigned, he didn't say how many it was. I had to get up and go get my Bible. Was the same as the number of years from his death to the exile. I tried up. I remembered that Manasseh had ruled over 50 years because I always thought, how unfortunate that the worst king ruled the longest. And it was over a half century. I was thinking it was like 51, 53, something like that, but it's 55. We just read it. And then his son was two, and his grandson 31, and then these guys. You know, and it talks about in the so-and-so year of so-and-so year. So you say, well, you got an extra half a year in there. Well, probably not, because they counted whole years whenever they got into it. But anyway, there's a 55 there. And there's a sowing and reaping there. Obviously, the scripture is clear. What Manasseh did caused the exile, caused them to be taken out of the presence of God, and literally the temple burned down. I think that's awesome. I think it's a good thing that that temple was burned down. I don't think it could be cleansed. Okay. So it's the same. And look, I didn't know how many years Manasseh reigned when I went to bed that night. And I didn't know how many years after he died it was until the exile. And I certainly didn't know that they were the same. I got up, checked the scripture, and there it was. What does that mean? Well, it means sowing and reaping. Yeah, well, why did the Lord choose to give me a factoid on May the 3rd, 2023? And this is not necessarily going to make you happy, but here's what I believe. I believe that judgment is now inevitable for part of the United States of America. I believe that the country is coming apart, and there will be a remnant that will be spared. A remnant shall return. A remnant will be spared. It may very well be politically that there are sheep states, goat states, red states, blue states. I don't know. But I do believe the country's coming apart, and there will be places of righteousness and shieldedness, and places of unrighteousness and judgment. And that when it happens, and I don't know when it's going to happen, we will look back and see that the numbers fit. Well, what numbers? Well, that's what takes revelation to know. I don't know, but I have tried to look at Roe v. Wade. You know, started in 73, ended 49 years and 5 months later last year, 2022, June 22, the Dodd decision. But since then, think about it. The bad's getting better and the good's getting gooder, and now the states with abortion have gotten to where that abortion is more and more unlimited up to the time of birth in at least a dozen, if not 15, 18 states. And but then there are other states where they made abortion illegal altogether since the Dodd decision. So in other words, you can see a separation, sheep and goats, sheep and goats, sheep and goats. And the blood is a big deal. It's about the blood. He filled Jerusalem with blood from one end to the other, sacrificing his own children. Now, just a note here before I come back to that line of thinking. Just for the record, since we're recording this, in July of 2017, the Lord was all that summer, part of that spring, summer, and into the fall. It took him that long to download to us the mystery of the silver shekels. If you haven't seen that, for pity's sake, go see it. It's on YouTube. The mystery of the silver shekels. But part of downloading that was a lot more than what's on the video, actually. But he was showing us all these timelines in the Bible, in black and white. Joseph lived to be 110. Joshua, his 12th generation descendant, lived to be 110. Joseph's bones were retained in a box until they crossed the Red Sea, and then rattled around for 40 years in the wilderness until they crossed the Jordan, and then they still didn't bury him till the last chapter of Joshua. When Joshua died at 110, not only then did they bury Joseph. Joseph and Joshua are buried there in the same chapter, in the last chapter of Joshua. It's there in black and white. They both lived to be 110. Well, 55 and 55 is 110 years. Furthermore, when the Lord showed us this, he was saying to us prophetically, the key of A is 55, 110, 220, 440, 880, depending on how low can you go and how high can you reach. Electricity is basically like that, 110, 220, 440, multiples of 110. He was showing us all of that in July of 2017 and even having us intercede in the key of A for the country. Approaching the 4th of July, he had me play the Star Spangled Banner in the key of A, interceding for the country. That happened back then. That's a little off the main trunk of what I'm trying to say. But I believe, and I don't really know exactly how this ties together, but that 110 divided in 255, that's a low note. An A at 55 is down here, boom, on the piano, boom, 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 somewhere down here. It's way down there. That's a low note. That's basso profundo. And this is a very low situation, but there's something there. Now, leaving that, going on to this. Look at 2 Kings chapter 21 and verse 7. This is page. So let's actually begin. Okay. Let's skip down and start with verse 10. Start with verse 10, 21:10. The Lord said through his servants, the prophets, Manasseh, king of Judah, has committed these detestable sins. He has done, prophets, again, you got plural prophets going on here. And we know that one of them is Jeremiah. Okay, he has done more evil than the Amorites who preceded him and has led Judah into sin with his idols. Therefore, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, I am going to bring such disaster on Jerusalem and Judah that the ears of everyone who hears of it will tingle. Okay, Jeremiah, in fact, says this same thing. The sins of Manasseh directly are going to directly cause a judgment that will make people's ears tingle. That's also in Jeremiah 19:3. So he's one of the prophets that said this. It's in his book, and it's talking about the same thing. It's talking about the destruction, you know, the worst of the worst is when they destroyed Solomon's temple. But looking back on it now, that's kind of like a mercy killing. But it'll make the ears of those who hear of it tingle. That phrase is only used one other time in the Bible. It's given the Lord when the Lord speaks to a little boy named Samuel. Remember, he says, Samuel, Samuel. And at first, Samuel thinks Eli's calling him. He finally says, speak, Lord, your servant's listening. And the first thing the Lord says to Samuel is, I'm going to do something that's going to make the, this is a 1 Samuel 3:11, if you want to look it up. I'm going to do something. I'm about to do something that's going to cause the ears of everyone who hears of it tingle. Okay, at that point in time, there was no Jerusalem as a holy place. It was in the hands of the Jebusites, and the ultimate holy city was going to be Jerusalem. But from the time of Joshua, when they crossed the Jordan, to the time of David and Saul, the temple was a tabernacle, and the tabernacle was at a place called Shiloh in Ephraim. Okay, Shiloh was the holy place. Shiloh is where the tabernacle was. Shiloh is where Eli was the high priest. Shiloh is where his two evil sons, Hophni and Phinehas, took the Ark of the Covenant out from the holy place. Again, this holy place had been defiled. They had been committing sexual immorality. The priests had there at this tent of meeting. Second verse, same as the first. So they carried, Hophni and Phinehas carried the Ark of the Covenant off to go in the flesh to battle the Philistines. They were killed. 32,000, I think, Israelites were killed, and the Ark of the Covenant was captured and went into Philistine hands for a time. And it was too hot of a hot potato to hold on to it, and it came back to Israel and wound up in a man's house. Okay, but the tabernacle of Shiloh was torn down. tradition tells us that Jeremiah got the Ark of the Covenant out of the Temple of Solomon right before Nebuchadnezzar came in and he hid it. That's one story. That's not my point tonight. My point is, in both cases, the holy place was leveled. Shiloh, which means peace, became a place of great war because of the people's great sin. And the same thing happened in both times. I mean, I just found this by spending my nose, keeping my nose in the Bible today, okay, y'all? I found out some of this, by revelation, but there's a place for study. Anyway, only two times tingle, tingling ears. Now, there's itching ears in the New Testament, but these tingling ears are when the holy place is about to be destroyed in both cases. I don't think that is coincidence. Now you understand these events were about 600 years apart. About 600 years apart. No, about 400 years apart. About 400 years apart. Okay, so I had another prophetic experience that I didn't want to have. I didn't want to cause this to happen, but I think it was a prophetic experience. So on the third, I had this visitation from the Lord explaining to me about Manasseh and the 55 years and the 55 years. So the fourth, may the fourth be with you. On May the 4th, I went to a meeting in Cullman, hosted by a friend, not myself. I had a great time there, had an encounter that was really, really important. But it's an hour and 15 minutes away, something like that from here. So I go, I've made it my, I've been attending his meeting regularly. And so I go one way to the meeting and come back another way to the meeting. I just felt like I was supposed to. On my way back, even though it's late, it was like 10:15, and I'm headed home, but I'm going to stop at two places, two churches to pray on my way home, 10:15 at night. That's weird. I know. I'm alone at these, nobody else is at these buildings. But just about 5 miles before I get to the first of those two buildings, something happens to me. Now, the context of this thing happening to me, as I had been saying, it's like I have this picture. I'm not saying it's a vision, but I had this mental picture of Manasseh getting a train going, a long, long train, and it's got this inertia going, and it's going fast, but it's also going downhill steep, and it can't be stopped. He himself, it jumps out. He's bruised up by jumping out. He's spared. I believe he's saved. I believe he's a trophy of grace in God's heaven. In any case, he jumps out, but the train cannot be stopped. He's spared, but the train can't be stopped. It's heading downhill. It's going too fast. So leaving this meeting Thursday night, going to a solo meeting, just for me and Jesus, I'm going down a steep hill in my car. A big buck, this is a big deer, steps right out in front of me into my headlights, and I'm going, oh no. And I hit him so hard that it deployed my airbags, which is hugely, is an extremely loud thing, bent my front, my hood, and knocked out a signal light, wrinkled up the hood, deployed these airbags. I've never been in a car with airbags deployed. And so I steer the car over to the side there. The gas in the airbags is choking. You can't breathe it. It throws this, some kind of talcum powder all over you. I'm trying to get out from under this airbag and unbuckle and get my door open and get out where I can breathe. And yet I'm okay. But my ears are tingling. My ears are still ringing somewhat from that. This is the eighth, that's been 4 days.
But for certainly for quite a while, my ears were ringing, my ears were tingling. But I was delivered. I was spared. In fact, my vehicle was spared. I thought my vehicle was totaled. The hood was crinkled up, and I thought I saw steam coming out of the radiator, but I didn't. It looks a little. It's the third deer I've hit. Okay, it's actually not even the worst one I've hit. But anyway, it's the only time my airbags are deployed. And I think that was the Lord saying the righteous can be spared. They will if they will get clear of the wreck. But there is we're going to hear of a judgment suddenly in one day. Suddenly in one day, suddenly we'll see it right in front of our eyes. Because when you're going downhill like that, I was probably making 60. You're going downhill like that. There's a bridge. I'm going down this steep hill to this creek. It's called Duck Creek there. And there's a bridge down there, and you can't steer. You can't turn and try to dodge a deer going down a hill headed for a bridge. You just got to hit it head on. It was not avoidable. And yet I'm okay. Other than a little ear ringing, ear tingling, those who hear of it will make their ears tingle. I think that was a picture. I was in the middle of serving someone else's meeting, being blessed, going to two other places to serve somebody else. And bam, that happens to me. I'm shielded. And yet, there will be consequences even for those of the remnant. Impact. There will be an impact. Our ears will tingle. Now, take it or leave it. That's what I think that was about. I think that was part. That was the day after the Manasseh revelation in my sleep. Okay. So I want to read one more thing to you to kind of put a bow on this, because there is something else that needs to be said here. 2 Kings chapter 20. Something else needs to be said. Okay. Chapter 20, here we're talking about Hezekiah, verse 1. Jesus. Here we're talking about Hezekiah. This man was listed as one of the most righteous of all the kings. He would have been in the top three, I'm sure, at least the top four. Him and Jehoshaphat, Josiah and David. These are the he's a very righteous king, and yet he had a hand in causing this disaster because of the way he failed to father, because of his passivity, which is exemplified in something else, and I believe manifested in his spoiled son Manasseh. I'll come back to, I'll give more details in a minute, but again, Hezekiah is the guy that cried out to God, and God told him through Isaiah, that huge army outside you will not fire one arrow here. And an angel goes out and kills 185,000 Assyrian soldiers in one night, and he's delivered because of his prayers. He's crying out to God. Then he gets sick, and he's about to die. And he gets a word from God, and God heals him and gives him 15 more years of life. Gives him 50 more years of life. Is that a good thing? Let's see. 2 Kings chapter 20 and verse 1. In those days, Hezekiah became ill and was at the point of death. The prophet Isaiah, the son of Amoz, went to him and said, "This is what the Lord says, put your house in order because you're going to die. You will not recover." Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed to the Lord, "Remember, O Lord, how I have walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion, and have done what is good in your eyes." And Hezekiah wept bitterly. Before Isaiah had left the middle court, the word of the Lord came to him, "Go back and tell Hezekiah, the leader of my people, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I have heard your prayer and seen your tears, and I will heal you. And on the third day from now, you will go up to the temple of the Lord, and I will deliver you and this city from the hand of the king of Assyria. I will defend this city for my sake and for the sake of my servant David. Then Isaiah said, prepare a poultice of figs. They did so and applied it to the boil, and he recovered. And Hezekiah had, this is one of those places where you get a kind of a prequel. Before the healing, this he had made this statement. It's interesting how this is sequenced here. Hezekiah had asked Isaiah, what will be the sign that the Lord will heal me and that I will go up to the temple of the Lord on the third day from now? He's asking for a sign. He's feeling so low. Isaiah answered, this is what the Lord's sign, this is the Lord's sign to you that the Lord will do what he promised. Shall the shadow go forward 10 steps or shall it go back 10 steps? There's a shadow apparently coming in the window from the sun. It's a simple matter for the shadow to go forward 10 steps, said Isaac. I'd rather have it go back 10 steps. An amazing thing. The sun went backwards. Then the prophet Isaiah called upon the Lord, and the Lord made the shadow go back 10 steps. It had gone down on the stairway of Ahaz. At that time, Merodach-Baladan, son of Baladan, the king of Babylon. This is Babylon's a new and upcoming kingdom. Now, they're very sophisticated. They've got a lot more technology, a lot more wealth, a lot more territory. And a lot more astrology. And they're kind of like New York City and Judah, where Hezekiah rules, is kind of like a country town. And he feels insecure when being visited by these PhDs or whatever, these big shots from Babylon. And this is, you know, this is a pattern throughout the Bible, the fear of man and the love of his praise. Balaam did the same thing when the big shots came to visit him. But at that time, Merodach-Baladan, son of Baladan, king of Babylon, sent Hezekiah letters and a gift because he heard of Hezekiah's illness. And Hezekiah received the messengers and showed them all that was in his storehouses, the silver and the gold, the spices and the fine oil, his armory and everything found among his treasures. There was nothing in his palace or in all his kingdom that Hezekiah did not show them. He showed them everything, including what was in the temple, trying to impress them with his giftedness. In his insecurity. I mean, this guy had just had God have the sun turn back 10 steps, 10 degrees, and he's insecure around these pagans. Trying to impress him. That's a real passivity. One of my favorite phrases, and this is recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. In particular, it's in Matthew 22, in case you want to check on it. But when they were trying to trick, the enemies of Jesus were trying to trick him, they paid him a compliment. They told the truth about him, and they said, we know that you do not look at men's faces. It's what it literally says. You do not consider who people are. In other words, Jesus, are not impressed by big shots. But what it says in the Greek is, you do not look at men's faces. You're not intimidated. We are so often. We give way to titles, position, three-piece suits. Jesus. But Hezekiah is giving way here. Then Isaiah the prophet went to King Hezekiah and asked, what did those men say and where did they come from? From a distant land, Hezekiah replied, they came from Babylon. The prophet asked, what did they see? In your palace? They saw everything in my palace, Hezekiah said. There's nothing among my treasures that I did not show them. Then Isaiah said to Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord. The time will surely come when everything in your palace and all that your fathers have stored up to this day will be carried off to Babylon. Other than the Ark of the Covenant, everything, including the contents of the temple, was carried off to Babylon. The exile happened. And it's clear in Scripture that the direct reason was Manasseh, four generations before it happened. And yet, in a sense, it's Manasseh's fathers fault. He started the ball rolling. Nothing will be left, says the Lord, and some of your descendants, your own flesh and blood, that will be born to you, will be taken away, and they will become eunuchs in the palace of the kingdom of the king of Babylon. In other words, they will lose their manhood. They will be neutered. I'm sorry, sad story, but that's what happened with Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The blood line of David was cut off because of this passivity. As a matter of fact, Hezekiah's worse than that. Hezekiah's grandsons are going to be sacrificed by his son to demons, plural. And this is what Hezekiah's reply was. This shows you the weakness and passivity of the man. This shows you the classic situation of the passive male leader. Adam was standing there while his wife's talking to the snake because she hands the fruit to him and he doesn't do anything about it. He says, "The word of the Lord you have spoken is good," Hezekiah replied, "for he thought," this is his thinking, his thoughts. That's what he said, "The word of the Lord you have spoken is good." Isaiah had want to fall on the floor. But he's thinking, "Will there not be peace and security in my lifetime?" And that is what caused the Babylonian exile. And yet Manasseh caused the Babylonian exile. One more little note as I close. Manasseh standing there hearing these horrible words come out of this man of God. Mostly, our problem is the church. Isaiah was a prophet, but he probably does not know that because of this passivity, during this 15 years, a son is born. If I remember right, in the third of the 15 years that God added to Hezekiah's life, he was going to die. And then he gave him 15 more years. In the third year, his son Manasseh is born. I think this is pretty quick after he was healed. Probably in the first year or two of the 15. I don't know that, but I believe that. But this prophet Isaiah doesn't know that there's going to be a baby boy born over there in Manasseh. And that later on, Isaiah will be sawn in two by Manasseh. Thank you, Lord. In judgment, remember mercy, we pray. We know there's a point where the train can't be stopped. And we want to agree with you, whatever you're saying, and we think this is what you're saying from your word and by the Spirit. In Jesus' name, help, Lord. In judgment, remember mercy. Amen.